I want to welcome you tonight and tell you that we're going to have a wonderful speaker who is Lakeland's own, Jeff Sudbrook from the News-Herald. And I'm going to talk in a minute about what it is that he has done and how he's been connected with Lakeland. In fact, he has his Associate of Arts degree from Lakeland. And while attending Lakeland, he was very active in athletics and was chosen as the All-Ohio Junior Conference baseball player for 1982 and 1983. And from 84 to 88, he was at Lakeland as the sports information director. During this time, he hosted two cable television shows called Sports Talk and Browns at Camp that featured Lakeland and area high school athletes. He attended Ohio School of Broadcasting, and afterwards he joined the News-Herald as an account executive in 1988. He was promoted twice and became advertising director in 1998. In 2004, he was promoted to publisher of the Morning Journal in Lorain, and in 2010, he was promoted again to senior publisher of both newspapers, the Lorain Morning Journal and the Lake County News-Herald. He's a former co-chair of the Lorain County United Way and a board member of Clothe a Child. He is a member of the Lakeland Alumni Hall of Fame, and he lives in Avon with his wife, Cheryl, and their two children. So would you please join me in welcoming Jeff Sudbrook, publisher of the News-Herald.
Thank you. Absolutely, thank you.
Well, good evening, everybody, and welcome. I have to ask you a question. Did you silence your cell phone? All right, now let me ask you this. How many have a smartphone? Hold them up, let me see them. Every hand just about has some type of cell phone or smartphone. How many of you read the newspaper this morning? Very few hands there. That's pretty much what we're gonna talk about, is what's going on in the newspaper industry today and how this new digital media and the internet has it affected the newspaper industry. First of all, as Chris just mentioned, and I'll just recap some of that for you. I am a local guy. I grew up in Painesville Township, attended grade school in Painesville Township, went to junior high school in Painesville Township, and graduated from Riverside High School. Any Riverside graduates in the crowd? Great. I probably graduated a few years before you. After graduating from Riverside, I decided to attend Lakeland Community College, but only part-time, because I was actually right out of high school hired by the Painesville Telegraph as a part-time sports reporter. So that was my first taste of journalism. I had just turned 18 years old, and I was already being published in a newspaper in the Painesville Telegraph. Well, that didn't last too long. I finished the year out doing that, and then decided I wanted to get back to my baseball career, which Chris mentioned. So I decided if I wanted to play baseball and be a Major League Baseball player, just about like every little boy wants to do at some time, and I'd yet to grow up, I might as well go out and play with the best, and that would be in one of the best areas for baseball. That was Arizona. I had some family out in Arizona, so I attended a community college in Glendale, Arizona, which is now where the Phoenix Cardinals, or Arizona Cardinals football stadium is located. And I actually went out there to play baseball. And my ambition was I'd play there a year or two. I'd go on to play for Arizona State University, one of the best baseball schools in the nation, and they still are. Get drafted, go play in the major leagues. Simple as that. Didn't work out that way. You know, you've all heard those stories. You may even know somebody in your family, could have been your father or a brother or somebody like that, that tells you, like, I could have been a Major League Baseball player, but I hurt my arm, or I blew out my knee, or something like that happened. You've heard some people that have those stories. That wasn't me. I wasn't good enough, so I didn't make it. So that put me on the track back here to come back to Ohio. Luckily, Lakeland did have a baseball team. So I got to come back to Lakeland Community College, where I grew up, go back as a full-time student, got to play baseball still for the next year and a half, but I obviously realized at that point in my life it's time to quit thinking I was going to major in baseball and find something else that maybe I was good at, and find myself back at the community college knowing that I needed a degree. So back in January of 1982, I came back to Ohio in Lakeland, and I did earn my associate's degree in 1983. My years here at Lakeland, as a student, I look back now at the best times of my life. Besides baseball and the friends that I met and this institution to see what it did for me by providing me those opportunities, and even after I left for a while to come back here in order to get my degree, it offered me that opportunity that if it wasn't here for me, I'm not sure where I would have went from Arizona. But after Lakeland, I decided I wanted to be a sports broadcaster. I still loved baseball, but I loved a lot of sports, and I wanted to get into broadcasting. I loved to talk. So I enrolled at the Ohio School of Broadcasting, and after completing my degree in radio and television broadcasting, I started working at weekends at a local radio station in Painesville, which I believe is still there, but when I was there, I think it's still 1460 AM on the dial. It was WQLS then, and I believe it's still there. And I returned to Lakeland then as the sports information director, as Chris said, from 1984 to 1988. I worked closely with the athletic director and the coaches promoting the sports here at Lakeland. And at that time, the Lakeland Cable Network was functioning, and I started broadcasting some of the games, both basketball and some of the other volleyball and some of the other sporting events. Then I started hosting the Sports Talk Show, which was designed to promote the athletes here at Lakeland Community College and to help them go out and recruit and bring potential athletes and students to the college, and also feature some of the better high school athletes in the area. So as we did that, then I was fortunate enough during those mid-80s that the Cleveland Browns actually held their training camp here. I don't know if many of you realize that or not, but in the mid-80s, the Cleveland Browns held their summer training camp right out here in what is now the baseball field and the soccer field. So I was fortunate enough to be here then, and I actually hosted a show. I became part of the media that was aired on the Lakeland Cable Network, went out and found my own advertisers to sponsor it and support the show, and had a Browns at Camp show. Now, mind you, I was a whole 22, 23 years old at the time that I was getting to do that. That was pretty fun. Not only to be around Lakeland again and be around the Cleveland Browns and those professional athletes, but I was around the people in the media that had been covering the Browns for years, such as Hal Lebovitz and Bob August and Chuck Heaton, some people like that. So that was a big deal for me here to have that chance and be with the Cleveland Browns and be back at Lakeland. So as we produced those shows during the summer that they were there, that was one of the best times again, and I really enjoyed being here at Lakeland Community College. But in 1988, I decided to join the News-Herald as an account executive. I originally interviewed at the News-Herald to be a sports writer, of course, after I was leaving here at Lakeland College. Be quite honest with you, I didn't like the hours. The sports writers, now I'm 25 years old, the sports writers are pretty much working every night from 6 o'clock till 2 in the morning. That didn't seem much fun for a 25-year-old boy. So I actually took a job in sales. And I started my career there because, one, I liked the hours were better, and two, I had a chance to earn more money. I look back and I think that's probably the best decision I ever made. I'm fortunate enough to hear tonight the person that actually hired me at the News-Herald is here tonight. He's a retired publisher, Rick Stanger. And I have to tell this story, and I hadn't planned on it, but when Rick interviewed me, knowing my background was in sports broadcasting, and we sat down to interview, and at first I interviewed with his retail manager, and I suppose his retail manager went into his office and said, he's a good fit, we should hire him. Talk to him. First thing Rick told me when he looked at me, he says, you don't want to do sales. I know what your background is. Your background is sports broadcasting. As soon as you get a better job in sports broadcasting, you will leave. And I promised him, I will not leave. I promise I'll stay at least 1 year. I will not leave. That was 1988. I've worked for the News-Herald or the same parent company since then. He's retired on me. I stayed. He didn't. So I was promoted twice and eventually got up to be the advertising director. And then in 2004, as Chris said, I left the News-Herald, stayed within the same parent company. I had the opportunity for another promotion to move to Lorain, Ohio, to that newspaper, the Morning Journal. Now, I took the job sight unseen. I'd never been to Lorain in my life. I've been by it on Route 90 and Route 2, and I knew where the exit was, but I've never been there. It was quite a shock to me when I accepted the job, drove out there that weekend to actually see the city of Lorain and actually the building that I was in. It's a lot different than Menor, and it's a lot different than the News-Herald building. But I found a good, hardworking town and community over there, and it's one of those papers that are just like the News-Herald. They believe in what they do with their community, and their workers truly believe in it. So I found another home over there since 2004. Luckily, in 2010, the parent company, the Journal Register Company, asked me to come back and also be the publisher of the News-Herald, giving me dual roles. So in a way, I'm back home, although I'm still living in Avon, Ohio, as Chris said. You know, one way or the other, I'm going to be driving back and forth, but Lake County's been my home. That's where I spent the first 40 years of my life, and it's good to be back here. So that's my journey to the News-Herald. Now let's talk about the News-Herald. I'd like to start with a short video here that I'll show you here shortly. It's about the News-Herald. It'll highlight some of the past, some of the present, and hopefully talk to you about where the newspaper industry, or as we call it now, the digital-first industry, may be going. In how we're trying to deliver the news and our advertising messages across multiple platforms. The News-Herald has been serving the city of Willoughby and surrounding counties for well over 100 years. The News-Herald roots go back as far as the Willoughby Independent in 1879. Major changes and expansions over the years include the merger with the Willoughby Republican, purchase of the Painesville Telegraph, move to 7 days a week, switch to a morning publication, and a 24/7 cycle that is beyond print. Even after more than 130 years, the News-Herald's commitment remains the same. An award-winning news and information source is only part of the package. Providing local news when it happens is available on newsherald.com.
Technology is changing the ways in which we are able to provide information. Tools like Facebook and Twitter enable us to engage readers like never before. And while readers of the News-Herald are accustomed to seeing our award-winning photographs, users at newsherald.com are seeing their news in motion and constantly evolving. But what hasn't changed is our commitment to providing the most accurate, up-to-date information possible.
Besides providing local news and sports in print and online, the News-Herald provides superior coverage and targeted delivery to better serve advertisers who want to reach a local audience.
The News-Herald advertising department has many advertising programs to fit your need. Included in that are display ads, which not only allow you to pick the size of the ad, but also the placement included in the Daily News-Herald, County Chat, or County Kid publications. Are you a business looking to hire an employee or a homeowner looking to sell an unwanted item? Our classified section will surely get it sold.
Hi, I'm Patty from Barb and Patty's Butcher Palace, and this is Barb.
Hi, we've been advertising with the News-Herald for over 30 years now, and we just love advertising with the News-Herald. It's been a wonderful community paper. They bring in their coupons, and it's just been a wonderful experience for over 30 years now.
Providing readers with award-winning news and advertisers the ability to reach their desired market goes well beyond the printed product. Local news and higher exposure to local advertising revenue is a large part of what the News-Herald provides. But the News-Herald is more than just a business. We are part of the community.
Here at Lake Health, community and partnership are the most important things that we do. And the partnership between Lake Health and the News-Herald have provided many opportunities for our community to come together and get exercise and good health. And in one of those partnerships is our Johnny Cake Jog. In the Johnny Cake Jog, we're able to provide not only an opportunity to exercise and get out there and really do stuff in our society that is having trouble with that already, but we're able to provide health care also through our athletic training and our sports medicine program. But that partnership has allowed us, Lake Health and the News-Herald, to come together and make community that much stronger.
Press time for the News-Herald is 2 a.m. With press speeds of 25,000 an hour, we generally clear the dock by 4 a.m. to ensure early morning delivery for all of our customers.
Contact the News-Herald, your local connection to your local community. The News-Herald, it's all you really need. The News-Herald has been a part of this community for over 130 years. That's quite an accomplishment. Obviously, there have been a few name and ownership changes, as we saw there in the early part of the video, but any business will tell you, you have to be able to change and adapt to make it year after year. and the current challenges of the newspaper industry and our economy are no different. One of the other people that I think you saw there, or did not get the chance to see there in the video, but you saw that wall of plaques in our newsroom. And one of the other gentlemen that are here today, another News Herald employee, is Jim Collins. Jim Collins is responsible for a lot of those news award-winning plaques over the years. In fact, Jim was just recently recognized by the Cleveland Press Club Hall of Fame and was just inducted to their Hall of Fame just a few weeks ago. And Jim's done over 60 years now, Jim? 61 years. Jim's been a part of the News Herald and been bringing the news and some information to the community. But besides being in business for over 30 years, I find it remarkable that the News Herald and every daily newspaper that's still publishing 7 days a week, we produce a brand new product every day of the year. Think about that for a second. A brand new product is produced and published every day of the year. I can't think of too many businesses that can actually say that what they're producing every day is brand new. If you're rolling a car off the assembly line, maybe a different color, but it's still the makeup of the same car. That brand new product that we're producing every day has to have timely news, scores, photos, features, and more every day in order to keep our audience interested. And it takes the full 24 hours a day to collect the news, produce and publish and distribute each day's paper. You would think that publishing a newspaper every day of the year, we would eventually publish one, just one, a year that everybody agrees with. But that's not the case. Never has been the case. Probably won't be the case. You can ask anybody that works at a newspaper, there's not a day goes by that we don't receive phone calls that their paper wasn't delivered in the right place, not delivered at all. We've covered the wrong story. We should have covered this school instead of that school. We should have been covering this city council meeting instead of that city council meeting. We should have endorsed this levy and not endorsed this one. We should have endorsed this person and not the others. You get the message. It goes on and on when you have such a large audience. But the thing is that as long as we are reporting the news and reporting as much as we can here in the local community, we're trying to keep our audience engaged and report to them what we think they would find interesting. Obviously, we can't cover it all every day. Newspapers have found themselves under attack throughout history, and I just don't mean other competing newspapers and magazines. Some thought the actual invention and the widespread use of the telephone many, many years ago would hurt the newspaper industry, because now people could call their neighbors and call their friends and tell them the news or tell them what's happening. Well, that didn't damage the newspaper industry. But what about radio? And then television. Now people could now hear on the radio and see on the television what's going on around them. Oh, and then cable TV, all those channels and satellite TV. And of course, the internet. Information available anytime, any place, 24 hours, 7 days a week. Yeah, it's true, the internet has been a challenge to the newspaper industry. Coupled with the slumping economy that we've been facing the last several years, some newspapers across the country have not survived. They have went out of business. Many newspapers have now went to less than 7 day a week publication. They're down to 3 or 4 days. And in fact, our metro newspaper right here, the Cleveland Plain Dealer, there's rumors that that will be happening sometime early in 2013. And that's a very good chance that will happen to the Cleveland Plain Dealer. I often get asked by local business owners or people here at the college and administration, they'll say, how's business at the newspaper? My answer is always simple and consistent. The News Herald goes as your business goes and how the local economy goes. When it's slow for you, we're slow. When sales are good, more businesses are advertising, there's more grand openings, and more businesses are expanding. That's when the newspapers thrive. Since none of us have been able to actually have a major impact on the local economy, and it's dangerous to wager your future on the economy rebounding to the full state it was years ago, the News Herald and our parent company, the Journal Register Company, have made a commitment to a new strategy of digital first. This digital first strategy enables us to distribute the local news across multiple platforms. By doing so, we've asked our audience, the readers, to be a part of the news making process. By doing that, the digital first strategy We actually started that in February of 2010 under our parent company. We armed every reporter, sports writer, and photographer with a high-definition flip cam. With these flip cams, our staff creates on an average of 80 videos per week, which can be seen on our website at newsherald.com. The key to the videos is the same as our local news and our approach to that. We want to cover what is important to our local area, our residents, our local audience. No other news media has more people committed to covering the events of our area. The videos could be a short minute or two clip from a local sporting event, a school board meeting, a city council meeting, the fire, a winning goal at the local soccer game, but it's got to be a feature of our local people that our local audience is a part of. The News Herald has developed a community media lab at newsherald.com. There's currently over 90 members of the local community that are actively blogging and can be viewed on newsherald.com. The topics range from anywhere from a woman motorcyclist, a local doctor, Joe the coupon guy you may have heard of. The News Herald will assist them, and we will train the bloggers and help them. They can come into our building, they can use our equipment, they can use our archives, they can use our space, but what they are blogging is theirs. It is their information, it is their opinion. It is not the News Herald's. One of the other things you'll see on our website in recent years is the C-Click Fix, which is another digital venture with the News Herald, and cclickfix.com have partnered in an effort to empower area residents by providing an interactive tool to help them report non-emergency quality of life situations, such as a red light is out at a certain area, or there's a traffic jam here, or there's a large hole in the road that needs fixed. It helps the News Herald get that message out, it helps tell the public, and more importantly, it helps tell the public officials so we can address some issues. NewsHerald.com also offers additional high school sports coverage with OhioPrepZone.com, car buying tips and advice at FYIDriving.com, business and financial advice on our website under Your Money, and the current happenings in Lake and surrounding counties. And breaking local news is always on NewsHerald.com 24/7. Or join the more than 13,000 News Herald fans that follow us on Facebook, Twitter, and SMS. NewsHerald.com page views have recently grown to nearly 5 million in September. 5 million page views in the month of September. And unique visitors to our website during that same month of September, unique visitor counting each IP address only once during that month, is nearly 1 million. The News Herald is also available on your mobile device. Maybe some of you have it now. Nearly 400,000 mobile page views in September. And with the News Herald internet audience growing, advertising opportunities are growing as well. So the internet, our competitor, not with our digital-first strategy. We're turning the internet, especially the NewsHerald.com, into our future. And we are not done yet. There'll be many new and exciting opportunities for readers and advertisers will be announced and launched in the coming months. With all the talk about NewsHerald.com, I've not mentioned the printed News Herald product that much. Circulation at the News Herald has declined over the past 10 years. It's declined at every daily newspaper across the country in the last 10 years. That's the challenge that we're facing. How do we embrace this new technology? How do we still try to satisfy the readers that we have? How do we grow our audience digitally in order to support the printed product so we can continue publishing for 7 days a week? Nearly 40,000 copies of the News Herald are still sold every Sunday. That's a large audience in Lake and Geauga County still reading the News Herald. It's still the most popular and the most effective way to reach print readers in Lake and Geauga counties. As I close, and then I'll take your questions, I want to assure everyone that the News Herald commitment remains the same. Provide the best local content on multiple platforms so we remain the number one choice in our communities. I start every morning reading my local newspaper. I'm 50 years old. I still get up every morning, and as I've done for the last 25 years probably, walk out to the end of the street where my paper box is. I don't want it thrown to my front door. Pull that newspaper out of there, sit down with my coffee and breakfast, and read that newspaper first. The difference is now, during the day, I get my updates through the websites, thenewsherald.com, morningjournal.com, cleveland.com, wherever that may be. That's where I want to find out where that breaking news is. That is the digital first strategy. As soon as the news happens, tell your audience, tell your readers. That's where they're coming to look to see what news is happening. And then the following morning, we follow that up by publishing in print that printed message that you can hold on to, possibly have more details, more information, see that local photo, see that local score of that local sporting event. The News Herald plays such a vital role in the communities we serve. You saw there from Lake Health how we had the Johnny Cake Jog. I would imagine some of you in this room have participated in the Johnny Cake Jog, the 5 mile, or the walk, or maybe some of your family members have. It's one of the many ways that we engage with our audience, with our community. Clothe the Child, some of you may be familiar with that. Clothe the Child is, I would say, about 50 years old right now at the News Herald. The Clothe the Child is where our community members are donating money and time and effort so that we can provide clothing and shop for needy children in this area for their qualified families. And that is all done by the generous support of the community. The News Herald pays all administration costs. Every dollar that is given to Clothe the Child goes directly to put clothes on that young boy or girl who's in need. I hope you enjoy reading your News Herald and will continue to do so for many years to come, whether that's in print or newsherald.com. We hope that you remain a reader because the News Herald's going to be around for plenty more years. Thank you. I believe this is the chance where they can ask questions. That's a good question because we're trying to prepare for something. We're not certain it's going to happen. We don't know when it's going to happen because obviously the competition's not going to tell us. And you also have to assume that they're not stupid. They didn't stay in business this long. So before they make a decision to cut their print product, they're going to be investing in Cleveland.com in their website because they need to retain that business they're going to be losing from advertising. They need to retain that business they're going to lose from their subscriber base. So we're gearing up for that now already from the digital side and making sure that we have the resources and we're out there getting our messages out for their advertisers that we can also satisfy their digital needs. On the print part of it, absolutely. It's happened in Michigan. It's happened most recently in New Orleans. It's happened in Syracuse. There's been several other areas where the major metro newspaper has reduced its daily circulation to 3 or 4 days. Every other suburban newspaper, such as the News Herald or the Morning Journal, has gained home subscribers in that. But you just can't assume that the day that the plain dealer announces they're not going to deliver 7 days a week, that they're all going to call us. We have to get out in front of that when we know when that's going to happen. That message will be through our website. That message will be through bulk mailing. That message will be through our Facebook account, through tweets, through SMS, messaging like that, that the News Herald is still delivering 7 days a week. We'll make some special offers for any of those plain dealer subscribers that want to convert over to the News Herald. So it's one of those things that you're preparing for, but you don't know when it's going to happen or even 100% that it is going to happen. But it's highly likely that it is. I was fortunate enough, I know the publisher at the Plain Dealer. Had some time in his office with him this spring, late spring, early summer. And he just didn't seem himself. Didn't seem to have quite the pep that he used to. And then in September, he announced he's going to be retiring at the end of this year. And then most recently, the Plain Dealer this weekend, the Guild, their union affiliate, had some advertisements in the Plain Dealer. They've set up a Facebook account as well, trying to urge their parent company, Advance Newspapers, not to cut it to 7 days a week. So it's I'd be very surprised if it doesn't happen at this time, but the actual timing of it is still undetermined. Yes, I do think it's going to continue that way. And that's really kind of how I started here, by asking how many of you have a smartphone or an iPad or something like that, compared to how many of you actually read the paper. Assuming this is a younger crowd, 30 and less, that the majority of you are not newspaper readers. And I understand that. So we do think it's going to move more and more that way. Where it's going to stop, that's the million-dollar question. You know, none of the newspaper executives have figured that one out yet. Is there going to be, in my opinion, is there always going to be that need for print? I say always. Let's just say 10, 15 years down the road. Yes, I do believe there is. I do believe there's still going to be a large enough audience. What we do need to do, and is what we are preparing for, and Digital First Media is now nationally and internationally recognized for that, is by preparing to offer that news on multiple platforms. So 40,000 people on Sunday that still get the printed product. You know, actually from 15 years ago, that's down about 30,000. It was close to 70,000 back in the early 90s. So it's down quite a bit. That's no different than many other newspapers. What wasn't the case 15 years ago is what we've done now with those million unique visitors per month that are going to our website. A million different people, a million different IP addresses every month going to our website, and then going to at least, on an average, 5 different pages for 5 million different page views. Why we also have to do that is for our advertisers. You know, we have different products now. Besides, we sell more than just our website. We could sell any business, any advertiser, on any website basically in the world right now. When people go on there, they know exactly, as you probably know, most of you, they know exactly what your behavior is. It's no accident if you go to the Yahoo homepage that the advertisement that pops up on the right-hand side, it's probably something you're interested in, something that you've searched for recently. If you don't believe in that or don't think that's the case, go to your Yahoo page and then search for a Toyota or search for Cedar Point or something like that. Wait and see how many days it takes before those ads start popping up. They know what you're doing in your activity. So we sell to that. So we can go to a business and we can target what they're trying to reach. Are you trying to reach a certain demographic? Yes, we're trying to reach the 18 to 24-year-olds. Trying to reach male or females? Females. Trying to reach somebody that has searched for tanning salons in the last week, 2 months, whatever the time span may be. We can deliver those people to them. They can see their message then. So it's just not wasted necessarily going out to a vast majority of people who could care less. So we are trying to do that by targeting our message, and part of that is by having the content. That is what we do. We provide local content, and then we sell based on that local content. So the print is going to continue to decline. How much farther, how much faster, that's what we'd all like to know. You know, we'd like to think that it's about as low as it's going to go, but we don't know that. You guys would know the answer to that better than I would based on your habits. I imagine most of you, that your parents are probably still print readers, I would imagine. I know my parents are. You know, they have the computer, they have their email, but they're not going to the website all day looking at newsherald.com. If something happens in this area, I call and tell them. You know, they're not going to newsherald.com to see it. But they'll read about it the next morning in the paper, and then they'll know as much as I do about it. Yeah, that is one of the conversations I was having earlier tonight, too. Besides the newsherald.com, which is free to anybody, there's no paywall. You can go to newsherald.com, and I was asked earlier tonight, how much of your content is actually on newsherald.com and is it actually free? It's all free, and the majority of our content is on there. Most of the local content, most of the local sports content, but not all of it. You just can't get it all up there in a timely fashion. What we've done with the apps now, you can go on and you have several options. You can actually get the electronic edition, the actual newspaper, what it would look like. You can get it in an electronic format right here on your laptop, iPad, whatever you want. We also have the iPad app available now and an iPhone app available now in the recent months or whatever. So there's, again, serving in on the whatever platform our audience is most familiar with. The mobile being one of the most popular right now that he just mentioned. The mobile, and this isn't very old here for the News-Herald or whatever, having the mobile edition, it's already over 400,000 visitors in that month of September. 400,000 page views that are already going to that mobile. So that seems to be the future, and I'm no different. I mean, mine is set. I had to shut mine off like Chris instructed us to do, but you know, mine's beeping all the time and giving me alerts of what's happening. And since I work at the Morning Journal and here, between the two of them, I'm always finding out what's going on there. And with my iPad at home, this the same way with the different alerts. So that's what we're trying to do is make sure that our audience, whatever that may be, in print, by your laptop, if you wanted to get it from your computer, just newsherald.com, or the iPad app, the mobile views, that we're trying to satisfy all our readers and all our advertisers. Well, I'm pleased to say this, and I can't give actual numbers, but I am pleased to say this. Of the parent company that I work for, the Journal Register Company, which is now also the owner, it's owned by the Digital First Media, also owns the Media News Group, which is, there's some larger newspapers that you will know. The Denver Post, they own the Minneapolis Star, San Jose Mercury News. They own some larger newspapers, much larger than the News Herald. Our profit margin is still the highest. We have always, and I've been fortunate enough to inherit that from the former publishers, I've been fortunate enough to inherit that the News Herald and the Morning Journal have always been above the newspaper industry as far as profits. However, it is shrinking. It is shrinking. We have made reductions, several reductions over the years, especially, as I said, in 1994, I believe we moved into the News Herald, moved into the building that they're located in right now. Sunday circulation was about 70,000. 70,000 paid papers on any given Sunday. Now it's about 40,000. On that Sunday. So that's cut into that. Not only has that cut into your subscriber base, but your advertiser base. You don't quite see as many ads in print as you used to. When I was working there as an account executive in the 80s and 90s, every grocery store had all their ads in there. It was the Higbee's then, and it was Kaufman's, a May Company, all those. It was just loaded with advertisements. Well, now they don't do as many. Now maybe they just do one on Sunday. Now you can get them sent to you electronically. So that's cut into our profits as well. So our staff, we don't have as many people employed as we used to. It's probably been cut in half as well in the last 15 years. And actually, the Morning Journal, my newspaper in Lorain, we started printing it at the News Herald in 2007. So I've always felt that our two properties, which are some of the most profitable, I shouldn't say most profitable, above the industry standard as far as a profit margin, but we've also kind of tried to stay ahead of the curve in trying to see some of that coming by merging the printing both papers at one facility is saving some things that way. But it's and there's also some steps that have been made by the parent company that, quite frankly, I'm not in favor of, such as our circulation, our customer service department. It's no longer housed. It's housed at a third-party vendor. When you start losing control of that, you start losing some control of your customer service, and that's an issue. That's something that's very difficult. But, you know, I always scratch my head, and this model's been run by every newspaper for long before I was even born, but you work so hard to produce your newspaper and to print your newspaper, and 50, 60 years ago, then you turn it over to kids to go deliver it. All right, kind of strange. You have all these adults working on this product, and then you turn it over to kids to go deliver it on their bicycle and throw it. Well, now it's adults driving around at 4 or 5 in the morning delivering your paper. And if your paper's late, you don't get it to them for whatever reason, they probably have another job, or they got to get their kids off to school, and then the paper becomes even later. So it's very difficult that you do so much to get that paper produced, published, and then you try to get it distributed. And boy, if one thing goes wrong in that cycle, it can ruin the whole product. One of my former publishers told me, and I said it again tonight, no matter how good your product is, no matter how good your newspaper is, no matter how good that lead story is, it's worthless if it's not delivered to your customers. Yes. But I tell people, I joke, I said, I'm fortunate, I got two jobs, all right? But it is, and I'm glad you asked that question because, as I said earlier, I grew up in this area. I grew up in Painesville Township, so I grew up at the Painesville Telegraph. And then ironically, while I was at the Lakeland here working as a sports information director, and in 1986, the News-Herald purchased the Telegraph, all right? So I love the News-Herald. I loved everything about the News-Herald. I love this community. I grew up here. This is it. Well, then when I went to the Morning Journal in 2004, it was easy. I'm just going to go over there and make that Morning Journal newspaper exactly like the News-Herald. Thank God I didn't. Totally two different markets, two different newspapers, two different work habits. It's just not the same in there, but they both do have a lot in common about how they approach their job, how they approach the communities and do their work that way. So I seldom spend 2 days in a row at the same property, although with digital today, my smartphone, my iPad, and everything else, I'm in contact with both papers basically 24/7. So it is difficult, but the good news is I've got good people at both properties. That's why I kind of laugh when Chris had to come up here and do this for me. Yeah, I got people who can do this for me at both locations. So when I don't know what button to hit, somebody else does. I have a great general manager over here at the News-Herald, Brian McCloskey. He's been at the News-Herald as long, if not longer, than I have. He's a super guy that really cares about the paper, grew up with it as well, promoted from within. And I have the same kind of people over there in Lorain. But you're right, it is difficult, but I also say this, and I try not to have any of my other employees do that, although some do share joint responsibilities with me, but I try not to make them travel as much. I've grown up in this market, I've lived in this market, I've worked in this market. I didn't grow up in Lorain County, but now I work and live in that market, so that gives me an advantage. It's not like I just moved into this area and really didn't know either community. I've lived here for 42 years before I moved away. I've lived over there now for 8 years, and I'm still back and forth over here. My family still lives here. I've still got a pretty good grasp of it, but it is very difficult, yes. One of the most popular days for a newspaper and insert is coming up. What day is that? Thanksgiving Day. How many will get the paper on Thanksgiving Day or look at those inserts while you're at a family member's house? Right. That's still the number one way for Black Friday to succeed. Sure, you can go on the internet and everybody says now, hey, see the Black Friday specials at Target announced this week or next week. You can always get that jump on it. But I don't know, there's just something about it. I'm glad it's just not me. There's something about it on Thanksgiving Day, whether I'm at my parents, my in-laws, at my house, I gotta pick up those Thanksgiving Day inserts. I get them a week ahead of time than you guys do. I can look at them all week at work and know what's in there, but there's something about Thanksgiving Day and looking at those inserts, and it's no different on a Sunday. That's the largest day with the inserts. Sure, you can go online and take a look at those inserts, but you know what? You want to clip that out of your laptop because you want to go into Michael's and you want that 40% off coupon. You just can't rip that out and stuff it in your car. Sure, you can print it and come in with that, but it's just not the same to have that in your hand. And that's what the newspapers are known for, is those Sunday inserts, and Thanksgiving Day coming up is one of the biggest ones. That's one thing, like the Thanksgiving Day inserts, they want to know the advertisers, whether it be Target or Kmart, whoever it may be, they want to know the quantity they should send you back in April or May. They wanted to know how many they're going to send you. They've made their decision a long time ago, how many they're going to print, what newspapers they're going to go in, how they're going to get them distributed most effectively. Those decisions are made well in advance. Now, the good news is, for the newspaper, that sometime when those decisions are made well in advance, the market conditions could change, a product could change. So guess what? They have to make a correction notice. So now they have to buy an ad in the paper, too, that tells you that, hey, the offer on page A2 of the Sears insert is incorrect. It should have red. So we get to make money that way, too. So that's an advantage for us. But yeah, those are not made on a whim. And even delivered to the newspaper, your Sunday inserts are actually delivered to the News-Herald 7 to 10 days prior to they're actually put into the paper. Because on those Sundays and that Thanksgivings, it takes sometimes two, sometimes up to three passes to get all those inserts in there. And that's why that it weighs so much, it might fall out of the box, and when it's wet, it's a mess. They are not, ideally though, there's some opportunity there. With the bloggers, it is their, you know, they'll come to us or we will find them and have their suggested topic. We don't edit those, you know, but if something is offensive, we will stop it. But it is their topic. They are not paid. The reason being, it is giving you a chance for that additional exposure where you will have your work published, so to speak. And sometimes we reverse publish that. By reverse publishing, we mean that we'll promote it in the newspaper and say, be sure to check out, or we'll send out a tweet, be sure to check out Joe the Coupon Guy's blog today, great savings on this product. So it's getting that person some recognition, the blogger some recognition, and eventually there could be opportunity to sell advertising space onto that blogger's page, which in turn would make newsherald.com some money and the blogger. So there is opportunity there, but no, they are not paid because it is their content. Well, when you're basically have a 24/7 operation, and that is the thing, and that's probably the most difficult job I have as a publisher is teamwork and keeping all the departments together. Because if I heard it best many, many years ago at a advertising conference I was at, that you basically, I think of the newspaper as a ship. And you'll have different responsibilities on that ship. Well, the newspaper is no different. We have an advertising department that's responsible for advertising. Editorial is responsible for editorial. Sports is responsible for sports. Circulation. The printing, the production, the distribution, everybody has a job. So we have all these different compartments of the ship, but if one area of that ship starts taking on water, we're all in trouble. We could all go down with that ship. So the actual teamwork, and I learned a lot of lessons from Rick Stenger on that, the former publisher, is communication. Pull those people together, because we're not always going to get along. In fact, I was probably one of his department heads that gave him some trouble. He called me in a few times with some, because I would make, you know, circulation doesn't know what they're doing. They're not doing this well or not doing that well. Oh, really? He'd call the circulation director in, call me in, and we'd settle it right then. Because you can't work against each other. So we can work as hard as we want to get those ads in the paper, but we have to get them done right, and we have to get them done on a timely basis. Editorial has to know how much space they have on a timely basis, so they can get those photos and stories done so that the paper pulls together. That all has to get to the press room on a timely basis so the press room can get it printed and check it for any major errors on a headline or things that may go out wrong. And then the circulation department, as I said, that's the last straw. So it's a 24-hour period that everybody else, you can have a lot of ads in the paper, you can have some great stories and a great headline, you can print it and it looks great in color, but if you don't get it out to the customers, ball game's over. So the teamwork is very important in keeping all the departments together. And as I said, I tell them all the time, you don't have to like each other. I don't expect you to go out and go drinking with each other or go hang out at the movies. But when we're here together in the office, we're going to pull together to put out the best product we can. Well, on the green issue, I'm pleased to report that more than 60% of the newsprint that we use now is recycled paper, all right? And most of that comes from Canada and the different paper mills like that. You can get some of it here in the States or whatever, but more than 60% right now is recycled paper, which is a good thing. As far as the balance between advertising and the customers, That's a very difficult one. And I came from the advertising side, so I already told you which side I'm on. You know, I always believe the advertiser's right. In fact, I used to aggravate our editor and our other people when I was on the advertising side that I simply, you know, they say, your ad's too late. Because, you know, ads normally had to be reserved 2 days ahead of time to lay out the paper, and the ad had to be in at least a day and a half prior to that so you could get the ad situated correctly on the pages and do all that. I always said an ad's never late until the paper's in the box. That's when an ad's late. Then I can't get it in anymore because the paper's already been delivered. So, but that's an attitude you have from the advertising side. But now from the teamwork side, you certainly can't do that. You can't put your editorial people at a disadvantage day after day after day. But if they understand the mission of the paper, and I have these meetings weekly with my department heads, they know where we stand financially. They know what our challenges are. They know what our financial challenges are. They know what our financial successes are as well. So I think that's part of it, is keeping them informed of where we stand as a company. In fact, you know, where we're standing year over year. Are we above or are we behind last year? Currently this year, we're behind our pace of last year. We're making a lot less money than we did last year. But that doesn't put us in danger. But we've also made some adjustments, and now actually the second part of this year, we've had a much better part. Second part of the year has been much stronger than the first part of the year. So I think it's important that you, part of that teamwork and that communication is that your leaders should know where the company stands financially. It should not be a surprise to them. I mean, that's you hear that too many times in the business world, that I thought we were doing great, and they closed the door on us. You know, that's not a good way to run a company, I don't think. Well, first of all, I love what I do. All right, it's been very challenging, and it hasn't been as rewarding the last couple years, I will admit that, because of the economy, because of the state of the industry and things like that. But embracing the changes and seeing that we're just not, I always say there's three kind of people. The kind of people that make things happen, people that let things happen, and those people that say, what the hell happened? I always consider myself someone who makes things happen. All right, and that's what my company is doing now. We're not just going to sit there and let our newspaper industry go out of business. We are trying this digital first strategy and pushing that to a success. Can I unplug and shut it off? No. I really can't, but I think that's part of the reason I'm in the position I am, is because I do care about this. But more importantly, I don't care about making money as much as I care about the people that work for me, the communities that I work and live in, and the product that we're making. That's what I care about the most. It really disturbs me if we don't put out a good product. It disturbs me if we made an error in print or with an advertiser like that. That's not what my people, I have some great people that work for me. I have over 200 full-time employees at both products. And I know how much they work each and every day to make their product successful. But one mistake, as I said earlier, which we'll make a mistake every day, somewhere, somehow, we're going to make a mistake, that's what you hear about the most. And that's difficult. So I wish I could unplug from it sometimes. When I take a vacation, no, I'm still working. I'm answering emails. I'm on conference calls almost every day, whether I'm on vacation or not. And there's times, believe me, I wish that wasn't the case. I wish I could unplug from it, but I'm not that type of person. I just can't turn my back on it. I know I've got capable people at all the other properties, but I also want to make sure I'm available to them and to the customers for that part. You know, if we're doing something wrong, and I always said this too, we're not the telephone book. Telephone book comes out once a year. If you make a mistake, can't fix it till next year. We're a newspaper. We can fix it tomorrow. We're a website. We can fix it immediately if we make a mistake. So, therefore, we have to be on top of our game as well. Advertising typically with the ads has a deadline of 2 days prior. So, for instance, tonight, anytime from 3 o'clock to 5 o'clock tonight would have been the advertising deadline for Wednesday's paper. Okay? Now that means you have to reserve the space, we have to decide how many ads, and therefore how much space editorial gets. Editorial, it's predetermined, pretty much how much space they need on any given day, barring any election results or something like that, which takes up greater space. So the actual size of the paper is determined by the ad count. If you add up all the ads, and it would add to 6 pages, and we know editorial needs anywhere from 18 to 22 per day for editorial, sports, obits, all that, then that's how you determine the size of your paper. So that's why the advertising deadline is first. That comes first. Then the newsroom knows the information that they need to fill and how much they're going to fill each section with. Typically in sports, it's going to be 4, 5, possibly 6 pages on a Monday through Friday. Saturday could be 6 to 8. Sunday could be 8 to 10 on what the sports section's going to be. So they have a good idea what that's going to be. But then obviously the ads have to be built. The ads have to funnel back into those pages. The stories and photos have to be built. They need to be cut. They need to be edited to make that. So it's a hectic process, and I don't know if you've ever had the opportunity to see an actual printing press run, a large printing press like we have at the News-Herald or at the Plain Dealer, one of those. It's amazing. It's amazing how fast they do run and then actually see. I mean, I'm still amazed by it after 24 years. I watch it, and I don't really get it. I couldn't explain it to you if you asked me to explain it to you how that paper comes out of there every day. I'm not sure I could explain it to you because it happens so fast. But luckily they do. They know how. $40,000 is the actual paid subscribers. Now they typically on the readership, it's about 2.6 to 2.8 people per household supposedly read that paper. So you're looking over 100,000 readers on any given day. On a weekday, it ranges anywhere on a weekday. It'll range from maybe as low as 32 to as high as 38,000. All right, and then the big range is based on the single copy sales. You can imagine after Election Day, the Election Day results was one of our biggest single copy day sales on a Wednesday. It'll be bigger than any other Wednesday of the year. The Thursday paper on Thanksgiving, as we discussed prior, that'll be our biggest single copy sales day on a Thursday. And it all depends on what happens. I mean, trust me, nobody wants the Browns and Indians and Cavs to win more than us because it sells more papers. All right, I want Ohio State to be undefeated and to be bowl eligible because it will sell more papers. And it's just not sports that sells papers. And unfortunately, you know, and you've all heard this, oh, they only put the catastrophe on the front page and the blood and guts because it sells papers. Yes, it does, but that's not the only reason that it's up there. You know, it could be the biggest story because of it. It was a murder in this city or in this community, which is highly, you know, very unusual and very rare. But so it depends on any given day, but typically Thursday, Friday, later towards the week, or you have more paid copies.
But what's like the total of the week? Through the whole week? Like what is your average to the whole week?
Oh, the average on a Monday through Saturday, the average daily is about 34,000 now, is about the average. And a Sunday will vary anywhere from 38 to the upwards of 40. Yeah, that's the average. So they basically look at your paid subscriber, your paid copies. The Audit Bureau of Circulation looks at your paid copies on a Monday through Saturday average. They consider that your daily average. Yes, yes, that's correct. All right. Thank you very much. It's always good to be back at Lakeland. Thank you.